Welcome to Death Vibe, where contestants will earn reps for their argument for a chance to stand on top of the podium pedestal. I am your host, Lauren Khalil. Whoever I decide has the best argument through the final round will earn 30 seconds to talk about a topic of their choosing. On today's episode, we have affiliate owner and CrossFit analyst Chase Ingram with Get With The Programming. Founder and head coach of Underdogs Athletics, Justin Kotler. And the 2008 CrossFit Games champion and affiliate owner of NC Fit, Jason Kalipa. All right, boys, let's play Death By. Now that a handful of super teams have come together ahead of the 2024 CrossFit Games season, which team that has revealed themselves is the favorite? Chase, we will start with you.
A lot of exciting names out there. I think the big hitters over the offseason was, what's Noah going to do? Is Chandler going to do it with him? And then there's that split. So there's that drama that we're going to have coming out of Oceania. Kara Saunders' team with Newberry, DeRoy, and Porter is good. But I'm going to go Europe and Africa, little combo, even though most of them are Europe, with one New Zealand on that team. And I want to talk about the new Walleye team with Jamie Simmons and Elliot Simmons, Mia Hesketh and Christoph Horvath. I think this is a team that has a lot of experience. You think about what Jamie and Elliot did back in 2016, and Jamie won the Open, went team with CrossFit Yaz. They get podium, they get third. But with Mia Hesketh to me is the female Tola Morquinho. Sorry, Morquinho. Get that right for you, Sean. And she is one of the, I would say, most overlooked female team athletes in the space for the last several years. You think about strength and gymnastic skills, she is one of those athletes that you want on your team. Tola and Mia has put up some of the largest lifts we have ever seen in live competition for years. And she's been doing team for years as well. She's been there 3 years and been in the top 10 each time with a 6th, 8th, and 9th place finish. The wild card there is Christoph Horvath. You've got the pedigree of the Horvath in there. He's done a lot of team competition, individual competition. He has a lot of experience, but no actual team competition at the CrossFit Games. But collectively, they actually have competed together. The Madrid CrossFit Championship back in 2022, where they got second place to Spain's team that won't be there. I'm looking at the new Walleye team for the CrossFit Games.
Ooh, I like the pick. Justin Kotler, who is your favorite going into the season?
Yeah, I there are a ton of good teams, but I don't think there's any team that is stronger than Noah and Tola and Lena Richter and Matilda Garnes. I mean, that is a stacked squad. Noah, obviously, I mean, listen, you know, I understand he's a little bit older, but the guy's still top 20 at the CrossFit Games. You know, Tola, you know, we haven't seen Tola individually, but, you know, he's finished second at the Games now on a team last year and was second in the Open individually last year. And I was, you know, have coached Tola over the years. And you want to talk about someone who is not just an unbelievable weightlifter, but also could be the best pure gymnast in the sport on the men's side, you know, with his gymnastics background. And then you bring in, you know, two veterans, Lena Richter, obviously, you know, for Oslo, and she's an incredible individual athlete, and then Matilda Garnes now. I mean, I don't see how any other team, you know, leading into the Games, you know, looks as strong as that team does. I would say second is probably Chandler's team at Invictus, but this team is absolutely freaking stacked. And you know, I know also, you know, Tola didn't go down there to finish second again. So I think they're going to put it all together this year. I'd be surprised if anyone beats them.
Yeah, you don't move around that much to not finish at the top of the podium. 3 points for Kotler. Chase got 4 in that last round. Jason, who are you betting on?
So I'm just going to get maybe 5 to 10 points right now, and I'll tell you why. I'm going to summarize my points here very quickly. I'm going to go with Team Peak because there's 22 CrossFit Games qualifications, 5 podiums, 4 silver medals, and that's the team that I'm picking. Why? Because I like Noah Olsen. I think he's got great. I think he's going to pull out some great leadership skills for this team. I think that all of them training at Peak 360, especially like with Guido and that team. I think they're going to get good coaching, good atmosphere, good energy, and a lot of proven qualifications back at the CrossFit Games. So that's my pick. Simple and sweet, and I hope they crush it. I really do.
2 points for Jason. I'm curious. There are some strong hitting individual athletes, also athletes that we've seen in the team competition. But does this mix of like the individuals with the veterans on the team, does it make the competition more interesting? Are we going to, in fact, get more eyeballs on the team competition? And it could also be because of the new format with the system. I'm curious.
I think you're going to see more.
I think the best example of what we thought could be exciting and wasn't exciting at all was 2019. 2019 is where all bets were off. You didn't even have to train in the same space, qualify in the same space. You could just sign up a team to compete at semifinals or, I guess, sanctionals at that time. And it was all these individual athletes and super teams and can someone beat Mayhem? And it turned out to be the worst team competition in the history of the CrossFit Games with the biggest margin of victory of any team over the field. So no, that doesn't necessarily translate from paper to competition floor. However, I think one of the more exciting things we're going to have this week, this year is the team we didn't really mention once, which I was surprised nobody else picked this, but Chandler's team. And I want to say Chandler's team specifically, but like Chandler, Noah, we're supposed to go team. Mm-hmm. Something happened in the offseason and they are no longer on the same team. And then they are going to be going against each other with Joshua Alchama, Devin Kim, who both won the CrossFit Games in team last year. And then you throw in Lauren Fisher, who started her career on team with Invictus with a third place finish and then got second or third, I guess, with Annie's team in 2022. So
fourth. They missed the podium.
That's right. They missed the podium. Even better, right? So, like, you've got a team that's has a lot of stacked athletes in far as team success against, I think, a great story that we have as far as a rivalry at the CrossFit Games. So it might not be all the individuals on the team, but it just could be Noah versus Chandler. That might be the season for the
which I think will bring attention and eyes. Like, I'll go back to 2015, at least for me. You know, Froning and I both went team at the same time. And I think that that drove new eyes to the team area. I think that with Chandler and Noah both, and everybody knows the relationship, they're super close friends, and for them to be on different teams, I think it's going to add some I think it's going to add something too. I think it's going to drive more eyes to team sport. I know at least for me, I'm going to be paying more attention because I want to see what happens there.
Okay, on to topic number two. We're talking all about the CrossFit Open because at the time that we're recording this, it is just 2 days away. We will finally know what is in store for us for week one. So what are each of your 24.1 predictions? Justin Kotler, we will begin this round with you.
Well, what I want it to be and what I think it's going to be are two different things. You know, I'll be lucky enough to be out there. Alex and I hop on the plane in a little bit to head out. So I'm looking forward to that. And I know that, you know, we're hoping for something that's higher skilled and heavy, but that generally doesn't happen in the Open. So I am going to, this is what I talked about this actually, I think the last time, you know, my idea was, I think they bring back the 7 minutes of burpees, but this time I think it will be paired with a lift. So I'm going to go 7 minutes of burpees, 7 minutes to find a max clean and jerk. And then they do something along the lines of like, take the reps and the weight, add it together, and that's your score, 50-50, you know? So I think that would be really cool. I think that would be entertaining for the fans. So that's going to be my pick.
Didn't you say that you don't like a max lift in the Open? Were you on
if
that?
It's 50-50, though. So we talked about it being, you know, if it was by itself, no. But if you take 7 minutes of burpees, you take the max lift, you add weight and reps, put it together, that's a wonderful combination to be able to tell who's fit and who's strong together.
Okay. I like it.
It's what I said on the last show, Lauren.
After I had mentioned that that's what I wanted to put together, it was my event.
Man. Burpees and clean and jerks. Jason, what is your prediction for week one?
You know what? I gotta say, like, if you look at, you know, because Castro is now back involved in, on the launch, right? And so he puts up like this picture of like a mushroom with fungus on it or whatever it is. And
dive into this. I want to hear your idea of what he was thinking.
Well, I mean, look, he's obviously stirring the pot, getting people to think. And most of the time when you, I mean, it could be anything, right? But I love the idea of 7 minutes of burpees. I remember when that came out years and years ago, it was super inclusive, but also like extremely challenging. Whether you've been in the game for a long time or you're brand new to it, both people could get excited around it, which I thought was really cool. I mean, I remember doing that at least 4 or 5 times. So it was something I could repeat. And, but I also agree with Justin. I think adding some type of loading piece is going to be cool. I don't think it's going to be 7 and 7. I think if based on this mushroom, I'm going to say it's like, I'm going to say it's going to be burpees and a thruster. I think it's going to be burpees and a thruster. And I think it's going to be heavy thruster and burpee max. That's what I'm guessing.
And burpee max.
Like, yeah, like max burpees in X amount of time. Okay. And then find a heavy, like 3-rep thruster. That's what I mean. I'm totally speculating here, but that would be nasty.
Yeah.
Was it a 1-rep thruster last year?
Yeah.
Yes.
Or how about this? Accumulate max burpees and load in 10 minutes, right? So that you have to game it, right? So like you have to get in your burpees and get in your lift somehow strategically in a 10-minute time frame. How are you going to do it?
Okay. 2 points for Jason.
I need more than 2 points.
Because your guess was an open workout from last year. That's why you got 2 points. We did burpees and thrusters in week 2.
There's a reason why you see those come up more than anything else in the open, because they're badass, they're painful, and they're inclusive on the burpee side.
Okay, Chase, what do you have? What is your prediction for week 1?
I'll give that you guys are so close.
Oh,
so far away. You're overcomplicating this entire thing. Dave Castro said on the affiliate town hall, which some of you should have gone to, and you would know this, is that 24.1 is going to be so accessible for the masses taking this test that he could go across to his neighbor's house, not even be able to speak the same language, and in 10 minutes teach him how to do this workout and have him hit it as hard as he can. It is not going to have anything complicated in it. In fact, I don't even think it's going to be a couplet because of things we've seen so far leading up to this. I'm diving into the weeds. I'm looking at CAP. I'm looking at .com. I see burpee pull-ups and rowing on this past Saturday. All right, we're not going to have that for the open. I think you guys are really, really close when you're saying 7 minutes of burpees. Dave's not going to do that to us again. He said he wants something unique, but something that is going to test people's will and resolve to succeed at this. So you look at the mushroom, that thing is poisonous. It's going to kill you. What show are we on right now, folks? We are on Death By. We are going to see Death by Burpees every minute on the minute. I'm going to say start with 5. And every minute you add 2, and we'll just see who wants to keep going and beat the other person. Make no mistake, 24.1 is going to be death by burpees, and we are going to see who wants to keep going and who will quit, because at the end of the day in a death by format, you quit the workout before it's over.
Oh.
Can I give him 10 points?
Yeah.
I mean, Chase, take my money. I mean,
Listen, you asked a programming question on
that show. Was a very good answer.
We've never seen a death by in the open, have we?
Close. We've seen very, not necessarily like, death by, but we've seen intervals with an ascending rep format. Yeah. So you take the overhead squat, chest to bar pull-up workout, death by-ish because you added reps every interval, but the interval time window didn't change. So that's pretty death by. Similar last year a little bit because it wasn't death by per time, but it was an addition of reps per round with the burpee pull-ups and the shuttle runs. I think for the first time, we'll see an on-the-minute death by, because that's traditional death by. Death by has traditionally been on the minute, add a rep, add 2. It depends on the movement that you're doing. We saw something similar in quarterfinals. I believe it was for the age group division, and it was every 2 minutes wall ball shots, I believe, and it started at 20 or something, and then you added 2. So we've been flirting around the death by bush a little bit. This time, I feel like we're burning that sucker to the ground. The mushroom will kill you, and it'll be death by burpees for 24.1.
That's got to be a 6-point answer. Not 10, but 6.
Dude, that was a great answer.
Okay. Oh, God. That, like, how do you even prepare for that?
Wait, so are they burpees onto a plate? What's
so
the standard?
I think we'll take that's a great question. I think it'll be to an like you guys said, for 7 minutes of burpees, it was to a target that was, I think it was 6 inches outside of your outstretched hand. Last year, burpee pull-ups were just to an object that was out of your reach. I think for simplicity's sake and affiliates and garage gym owners, I think they're going to take the standard of out of your reach to a spot, and that's where you're going to do your basically burpee to target. It's going to take the measuring out of the way. It's just, can I touch it? No. Okay, you're good to go. I think that's they're going to use that standard plus the old 12.1 max burpees. Thanks, or Peter. Just like every year, I could be totally freaking wrong, like I am week in and week out for the last 14 years.
I mean, you look at last year, God, that couldn't be any different than what 23.1 was. I mean, 14.4 is my favorite open workout. I just think it's such a great workout. That's the row, toes to bar, cleans, wall balls.
Oh, and finish the muscle-ups, right?
Yeah. And it's an 14-minute AMRAP. You get back to the rower. I love that workout. I just think it's incredibly well-rounded. There's no bias there. It doesn't favor one type of athlete over another. It's just a great, great workout. And if you look on the leaderboard at that workout of 23.1, you'll see that those that finished top three in the CrossFit Games on the men's and women's side both were in the top 10 on that workout, which is pretty telling. Like the burpee workout, the only thing that bothers me is you're going to get outliers who are unbelievable at burpees, but who kind of suck at everything else, and they're going to fill up the leaderboard. But I guess it's not that big of a deal now because of the rules. So I think back at 12.1, we had wasn't he like a Russian, like a fitness, he did almost like what's that like aerobics.
Yeah,
he was an aerobics guy, right? Like Jane Fonda guy.
Him and Scott Pancheck actually tied,
and they got like 160 or something stupid.
That was for max burpees in a 7 minute drama.
It was ridiculous.
You know what we did that year is we layered pads. So we had a roof that was low, like a ceiling. And we layered pads to get it just to the appropriate height. So you could hit anywhere on the ceiling instead of like a specific item. Made a huge difference for us because you're just able to hit anywhere, right? But hey, Chase, you know, I would assume you being the expert level coach you are, you could walk next door to your neighbor, get a broomstick, tell him to squat below parallel, stand up, reach overhead. And do that. You could probably teach him a thruster clean and jerk. I don't know.
Clean jerk, that might be tough.
That'd be tough. But thruster, I think it might be able to do it.
Yeah, you could probably squeeze that one in. Yeah.
Do you guys think that there will be any repeat workouts this year for the Open specifically?
No, and I hope there's not.
I don't think so. I think it'll be something new.
Yeah.
You hope there's not, Chase? Why?
Yeah. I mean, I know the importance of a repeat workout. I mean, if you just look at the methodology in general, having benchmarks is the whole way we can see ourselves progress on an empirical platform. And, you know, that measurable, observable, repeatable part of CrossFit is why we are so successful. We can see the actual change in the mirror, and then we can see the difference in our stats when we look at our logbook. This is more of a personal thing. Is like, I love when they bring out new programming. I'm a super fan of that. I enjoy that. It's like CrossFit Christmas to me. So when they repeat something, I'm just like, I already have this toy.
I think if we're going to see a repeat, actually now, since we've got, we have enough years now, I think, of the quarters, I think you could see a repeat quarter. Because I mean, this will be the fourth year of quarters. Yeah. So I think now you could see a repeat quarter, and it would be interesting to see the data between how much people have improved. Plus you've got such a huge amount, you know, you have 25% doing quarters. So I think you might see a repeat in quarters. I don't think we're going to see one in the Open, but
I don't want to see a repeat, for the record, just because, my score will not be as good as it was before. I am less fit. Got it.
There you go.
Fair. Okay, we are moving now on to topic number 3, the Rogue Invitational. They just announced that they are moving out of Texas and across the pond to Scotland on the weekend of November 8th through the 10th. What is the biggest benefit of the competition moving international? Jason, we'll let you start off on this round.
Oh, boy. Well, you know, Rogue makes no secret. It's been diving deep with Europe for a really long time. If I'm not mistaken, that's their first area where they have a distribution center. So they have Rogue Europe over there. And so they're obviously super affiliated. I know Katie and Bill both spend a lot of time out there, and they're really interested in strongman type sports. And so I think Scotland is a really natural place to be if they want to shine light on storytelling around, you know, kind of like this old school way of strongman and stones and et cetera. I think Scotland, if anywhere in Europe, I think it was a good choice for them based on their brand and what they're interested in. I do think it's kind of a bummer because I really enjoyed being in Austin and I enjoyed the spectators. I don't think you're going to get as big of an audience in Scotland. That's just my opinion. But I think change is good. And I think you go out there, you give it a shot and you see how it goes. And I think drawing attention to these type of sports, especially the strongman type sports, and bringing CrossFit as another layer out there, I think it's a good idea. I'm just bummed because I liked Austin. It's kind of my overall take on it.
Fair. 3 points for Jason. Chase, what's your take on this one?
I'll start off by saying, as I guarantee you, you're going to get more people out there to watch the Rogue Invitational, because that was one of the drawbacks that I witnessed in person in Texas. I mean, it's just a 3-hour drive south for me. And if you look at Texas itself, is that what Rogue Invitational brings to the season is different than anything we have, including the CrossFit Games. It is the most exclusive competition in the CrossFit space. You're bringing your top 20 from the CrossFit Games. At least that's the initial invite. The qualifier is now its own beast when you look at that. But the thing about this, and some people might not like this, but this is the truth. American CrossFit fans are absolutely spoiled rotten when it comes to events in the CrossFit space. They get almost every single open announcement. We had 4 semifinals every year up to last year, and now it's 2. We've got Wadapalooza, now we've got 2 of them. We've had the Rogue Invitational and a lot of other massive competitions around the country, and the CrossFit Games since 2007. American CrossFit fans are spoiled. And the reason why I know that is because you go to a competition in Europe and those things are absolutely packed to the gills. If you look at a semifinal, I was on a phone call today with the international affiliate reps and they said our semifinal is our CrossFit Games. They show up in droves for these events. We saw that during the Invitational in Madrid. We've seen that at even the smaller events, the Italian Throwdown, the French Throwdown, which now will be a semifinal, strength and depth. And if you look at the isolation of affiliates in that area, I went the extra step. I took Texas and I super overlaid it over Europe. Texas has about 460 affiliates. In the same landmass, there's over 2,000 affiliates in that area that is surrounding Scotland. Scotland is going to be an amazing place. Not only that, but the venue that they're going to have, that P&J Live state-of-the-art facility, has about a 10,000 square foot arena all indoors. We talk about athlete experience is what Katie Henniger and Bill Henniger want for the Rogue Invitational. They are going to get that because you're going to have more people in attendance, which is part of the athlete experience. The weather will not be a problem, which is a part of the athlete experience. And if all that is there, you're going to have more fans walking in the doors and showing up with an international audience for the first time in the history of the Rogue Invitational. It will absolutely be the best invitational they have ever had.
I can also echo what Chase said about the amount of spectators that show up to an event. When I was at FitFest, same thing, nearly sold out. People were so excited to see these American athletes for the first time in their neck of the woods. 5 points for Chase. Justin Kotler, what are your thoughts?
I think just for the sake of the brand and global visibility, it's great. I think, you know, I am interested. I was very nervous when I first heard it, but the fact that, you know, they've got such a great facility. I think one of the things that was a bummer this year about Rogue, unfortunately, was the weather, and it really did change the test. I mean, you know, some of the events that were changed, you know, taking out pegboards and making it a handstand wall. I mean, it's completely different stimulus, you know, taking out the rope climbs in that sprint. There were several things, the monkey bars, you know, you had people that couldn't hang on who were great at monkey bars. It ended up really kind of you know, putting a damper on the event. And obviously Scotland with the weather, you never know what it's going to be like. So what I'm hoping is they're going to be able to utilize some of the beauty and some of the, you know, some of the unique terrain that you're going to have in Scotland. But what I'm hoping is that they program those workouts and it doesn't matter what the weather is. Like you can, you know, whether it's raining and windy and whatnot, you can be out there, but that anything that has to do with skill and whatnot is going to be indoors. So I'm hoping, really, really hoping they take that into consideration. You know, Chase mentioned athlete experience, which I think is huge, and also spectator experience. I mean, having to sit out in the rain the whole time is not going to be exciting. So I think for that sake, you know, it'll be cool. But more so, you know, I was able to spend time in Europe at the European, you know, semifinal this past year. And I think we see every year the European semifinal, the Australian semifinal, like they're literally like, you know, big rock events. You know, it's like you're going to Lollapalooza or like some of the crazy, you know, like the metal events that you see. I mean, it's wild with fire and this and that. And I think you have the opportunity to put this in a place where people are going to be really excited because they don't get those type of events all the time. Mm-hmm. So I think Chase did a very good job of kind of summing it up. You know, the only thing that will be tough, and the one thing that I am interested in, you know, this past year, Rogue covered a lot of the expenses for the athletes.
Yeah.
So when you talk about Scotland and traveling, I just really hope that continues to be the case. We're not at a point yet with athletes where they're, you know, where most of them are capable of having sponsors cover or, you know, where it doesn't hurt their pocket to take these types of trips. And Rogue obviously has deep pockets. So I'm hoping that they will continue to, you know, step up, cover athlete expenses and make sure that they're getting them there and back without any issues. So they can just focus on, you know, going there and doing the best they can and not having this really hurt them financially, which I think is obviously a big consideration.
For sure. 4 points for Justin. Is this what the community needs to kind of have a revitalization or like ignite some growth over in Europe, or will this not move the needle enough for something like that?
I don't know if they need a revitalization. Europe is exploding right now.
Right.
They're exploding with affiliates. They're exploding with open, like they have the highest open participation they've ever had. Since the games have started, like Europe is surging. And I think this is something that they have earned over the last 3-5 years at minimum. I said this last year that I think Rogue should go over to Europe. And so I'm pumped that they actually are because like I said in my long diatribe, North America and America is CrossFit is very US centric. They are trying to expand their horizons. And they need to get out to these places that are like France is exploding, right? And so to put something out there for Europe, which is basically, they said, instead of the semifinals being their CrossFit Games, they are getting something that is rivaling the CrossFit Games in their backyard. This mm-hmm. is what they have earned over the years. And so I think this is only going to just, not only just magnify what they're doing, but maybe exponentially join the path that they're currently on. Europe is absolutely crushing it right now.
So then does this have a bunch of like trickle down effect that will help the bigger picture for CrossFit as a whole, or will it in fact be a negative to the market of North America, Canada, and the US specifically?
I think it's a positive because we're oversaturating in the US market as far as competitions and major competitions. We're like, oh, we're not getting as many people show up. It's like, yeah, because they have to pick between like six massive events every year. Do I go to the West semifinal? Do I go to the East semifinal? Do I go to Wadapalooza? Do I go to Wadapalooza again? Do I go to the Rogue Invitational? Do I go to the CrossFit Games? Which one do I pick? Not everybody is in a position to take a time out of their busy lives on the year with families or friends and financially to do two of the six of those, let alone one of the six. So you take something like the Rogue Invitational out of the picture, I think that's actually going to improve the attendance and competitive ecosystem for off-season and in-season competitions.
How about that though, Chase? Do you think that the Rogue Invitational will impact the CrossFit like owned like events in Europe? Because I mean, if I'm a fan, right? Let's just say I live not in let's just say I live, I don't know, an hour, like a train, you know, you can train all over the place, right? But if you're not in Scotland and you're somewhere else and you have to delegate your time and resource, like you talk about, which one would you go to? Would you go to a semifinal or would you go to the Rogue Invitational?
So when you look
I'd
at
probably go to the Rogue Invitational. I mean, I'm bummed they're leaving Texas just because I love it being so close to me. But I also think the Rogue Invitational is a kick-ass event.
Well, here's the best part. They are two completely different competitions. The semifinals is the European Championship. The semifinals are divided fans by their countries. You go to a European semifinal and it's just blue and red for the Netherlands and red and blue. And like people are cheering for their countries at semifinals. It is like a soccer game pandemonium in Europe. The Rogue Invitational is a lot like the FitFest thing. They are now going to get a lot of the top competitors they don't get to see every day. So they're actually getting the best of both worlds. You're getting the most elite athletes that you will rarely ever get to see in person, whether the American athletes, the Canadian, or the South American, even the Oceania athletes. And now you get to see them for the first time in a much smaller format, right? And so I think it's actually the best of both worlds. And they're so
you don't think it'll impact
May,
you think they'll
May
go to
in
both.
November. It's May
yeah,
November,
completely
right?
Different times.
Highly spread out.
Yeah.
Now you potentially yes, but I think since they're so different. Right? Semifinals in the U.S., West, East, Wadapalooza, and Rogue, not necessarily Rogue because that's going to, like, those are basically all the same events, right? The games is different. The Rogue is like the games. So you still have a lot of things that are the same thing. So you're just like, oh, I pick one and I watch the other ones. It's fine. In Europe, now you get two different ones of some of the most massive events you'll have all year separated by 6 months. I actually think this could be the best thing for Europe. Mm-hmm.
Chase, what did you drink before you?
I don't know, but like my caffeine is like really.
I will admit, I felt like I should have won the last 2 weeks. Chase was in the zone today,
bro. I don't know if you took like alpha brain.
I got robbed the last two shows without question. Go back and watch them. I won the last two shows in my eyes. I won the last two shows, but today you were in the zone. I give it to you. Yeah, you were drinking.
I haven't eaten anything.
Yeah, that was good.
Yeah, your answers were very packed today, which has earned you another title, 30 seconds, topic of your choosing.
All right. I'm going to talk about this golden barbell thing, but I'm not going to talk about the athletes because there's a golden barbell for the community. And each week, affiliate owners, coaches, athletes, friends of coaches and athletes can submit online on Instagram, tagging the CrossFit Games, of certain weeks and certain topics. Week one, it's the heart and soul of your gym. If you know that person, put them on Instagram, put them in the running for this golden barbell. Week two is a local service open athlete. Week three is an athlete with the most standout performances during the open. You can submit these on Instagram, tagging CrossFit Games. Go look at their Instagram for more details, but join the community version of the golden barbell. The athletes, they get their old fun on their own ways. So I want to see the community barbell people show up in droves.
I want to see that too. I love that they're incorporating the everyday athletes. Get your submissions in. It's going to be a great open season. Boys, are you ready? Is everybody here signed up?
Yes.
No.
Am I ready? No.
I'm reluctantly signed up. I'm signed up because I want to do it. I just, it's hard. It is hard when you've been in this space for so long that you have these, kind of like subconsciously, you have these like ideas in your head of how you should perform on certain things, but they're based on your fitness level from maybe a year, 2 years ago, 5 years ago. And you got to like level set those expectations, you know? And that's hard to do because you think you're better than you probably really are.
I have no expectations. They went out the window before my kids were born. What's that happening at all? That's it.
So long ago. Chase,
you know what I'm talking about, though. It's like
I do.
A barbell comes up, 185 snatch. You're like, yeah, hell yeah, dude. I'm going to touch and go that for like 20 in a row. Then you get out there like, whoa.
Yeah. The elbows buckle and you're like, what the hell just happened?
I wasn't expecting that.
It is a humbling experience, nonetheless. Yeah.
Good luck in the open. We will speak again after. We have already done one, maybe even two workouts. Jason, Justin, Chase, so good to have you guys on the show. Thank you as always. And thank you everybody for watching. And we will see you next time.